Christmas Eve on BBC Two and some rather confusing news.
This Christmas, why not tune in for a special edition of Have I the Right by the Honeycombs? As usual, team captains Ian St John and Pauline Quirk will be joined by two star guests to take a rib-tickling look back at the year's weather. So join me, Antonia Fraser, for non-stop boxing action here on ITV.
The main points again. Have I got news for you? Christmas Eve at 10:15 on BBC Two.
Up tonight on Two for a perfect Christmas.
In the bleak midwinter
of war-blitzed Britain,
life was
dead,
dull.
Then God gave us
television
and TV reinvented
Christmas
according
to the Lord's
mighty schedule, turning it round
from a low-budget production
to a
lavish small-screen
feast
in glorious
grey-o-vision. If you were one of the lucky few
to own a television,
crowds would follow
yonder aerial
and gather
round your set
until you couldn't see
the 8-inch screen,
the neighbours,
urchins,
the donkey from number 5,
and the 3 wise
aunties.
Nobody dared turn off the set
because it took days to warm the valves up,
and you'd be blacked out
till the new year,
and the crowd would get
tiddly-poo
on your VP wine
and start slashing the seats
yelling, "We want the black and white minstrels!"
What era is this?
Hello?
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 Blue Peter.
In the 60s.
That was a swinging time.
Then came the age of colour,
volume,
glee. Enter the 70s.
Top
of the
Pops Christmas special.
Music
has never been better.
Trousers
have never been bigger.
There were real people in the studio.
A new generation.
Struggling to be interesting.
But not sure how to do it.
In tank tops.
And brown trousers. Then there were DJs.
Who were neither
fish
nor fowl.
Though they were more
foul
than fish. In an effort to spoil
all this fun,
BBC Two was
wall
to
wall
opera.
And films
about lonely
Swedish families
living on an island
with a dog
who loses his appetite.
The Morecambe
and
Why
special
was Christmas TV's finest hour,
with each year a surprising
star guest like Glenda Jackson,
more familiar to the audience
as the full
frontal
Popsy
of Ken Russell's epic cavorts.
How disquieting,
knowing she had Art Garfunkel's
hairdo
in her underpants.
It was all too exhausting.
Something had to give.
And it was the fun.
In the 80s, Christmas was handed over lock,
stock
and lime barrel
to Noel
Edmonds,
who was chosen for his name.
He brought in the
non-stop
Nothing Much show,
in which scenes of nothing
much
were filmed from a helicopter. Raid the archives.
Open the vaults.
Get back to the traditional values
of Christmas.
To a time when everyone smoked
Will's whiffs.
Even children.
In toothpaste ads.
A time when a man could buy his wife
an iron
for Christmas
and still get
a kiss.
Turkey sandwiches, Christmas cake, cups of tea, and Christmas night with the stars. For 15 years, it was a British tradition to curl up on Christmas night with the stars of that year's BBC variety. For a perfect Christmas, we've unearthed a choice example from 1964, hosted by Britain's favourite copper, Jack Warner.
Christmas night with the stars. Here is your master of ceremonies, Jack Warner.
If I'm not too late, Merry Christmas. And that comes not only just from me, but from everybody here in the studio, plus a whole host of old friends who'll be dropping in on you tonight. Friends you've been seeing throughout the year in BBC Light Entertainment. Well, by this time on Christmas night, of course, if you've eaten a little too much, or if you're feeling just plain exhausted, you may be starting to doze off. And so it is to you, first of all, that we say,
wakey wakey! Thank you very much. Good evening, everyone. Now, on behalf of all here, we'd just like to wish you a happy Christmas! Well, now, we've all been working very hard all day, and now it's time for a bit of food. So let's all go down to the kitchen. Today, our favorite diet. Just picture a great big steak, fried, roasted, or stewed. Oh, food, wonderful food, glorious food, glorious food.
Oh, I do like a nice mince pie. Yes, I do like a nice mince pie. Don't like lamb. And I don't like roly-poly, but I do like a nice mince pie. And I have a helping twice. Well, I have a nice mince pie, because it's nice, nice, nice.
Oh, I do like a nice mince pie. Yes, I
what are you doing?
Like a nice mince pie. What?
Get out of my kitchen.
Don't like lamb, ham or jam. And I don't like roly-poly.
Plenty more where they came from. But no show like this can really expect to get very far without that most essential character, the man in the street. At this point, we've just got to stop and ask his feelings about Christmas. To do the asking, we've got Glenn Mason. Oh, and don't worry too much if the man or woman in the street should look a little like Dick Emery.
Excuse me, sir.
Is that a microphone I see before me?
It is indeed. I gather, sir, that you're an actor.
Seymour Bloom, sir, master of makeup.
And how will you spend this festive season?
In the theatre, sir. On the boards.
May I ask what part you're playing?
Bottom.
Bottom? Ah, that's in A Midsummer Night's Dream from Shakespeare.
No, sir. In the back end of a horse from Boxing Day.
Oh, yes, we have a wonderful Christmas season, don't we, Pinky, darling?
Oh, this is Pinky, is it?
Yes. He used to be called Perky until he had his operation. We do have a lovely time, don't we, darling? And we have a party and all his doggy friends come. Then they all have their presents. And then they all have a wonderful time round the tree.
Well, this is a family affair, isn't it? You know, we usually have the wife's mum and dad, her brother Ted, my cousin Elsie and our nephew.
That sounds fun.
It would be, except cousin Elsie hates my missus. Her mum doesn't speak to our brother Ted. Our nephew gets on everyone's nerves, and Dad always gets blind drunk and locks himself in the bathroom. They stay the week, and then they all go home on December the 31st.
So it's not a very Merry Christmas.
No, but it's a ruddy Happy New Year.
I spend Christmas Day with Mummy and Daddy. Then on Boxing Day, I go to polo, and then dinner at the Cafe Royal, and then on to a nightclub.
May I ask who with?
Oh, certainly, yes. The girl I'm engaged to, Miss Amelia Forbes Watson Chumley Paunsfoot. My finance.
You mean your fiancé?
No, no, my finance. You really don't think I can afford all that on my salary, do you?
Well, I celebrated the occasion by creating a new hairstyle. I call it festivity. It's a sort of a semi-bouffant, you know, with flick-ups, sort of shoulder length, and a full fringe across here, and then a blue rinse, and a full fringe across here, as I said before, full fringe.
How long have you been in ladies' hairdressing?
Don't be daft, I'm in men's.
Yes, well, I reckon I'll get some records for Christmas, you know, like the Rolling Stones or the Beatles. Or Brenda Lee, and then I'll be playing them all the time, you see.
Yes. So your family like pop music?
No, only my brother, and then I suppose he'll be practicing on his new drum set, you see.
And your parents?
Oh, they, well, they'll turn the television up to full volume.
Just an ordinary sort of Christmas, in fact.
Yes, you know, quiet.
Oh, excuse me, sir. Hey, what are you doing for Christmas? 5 years if you don't get out of my way.
Excuse me, young lady.
Flatterer.
Do you look upon this as a season of goodwill?
Do I?
I mean, what are you going to give your boyfriend for Christmas?
What? You are awful. I like you.
I don't want to drag Bob Hope into this program, but I feel we must say thanks for the Emerys. Did you say something? Oh, I'm sorry. We don't have to ask the man in the street, though, to know what the trend in pop music was this year. It was groups. Big groups, small groups, short groups, tall groups, long-haired groups, no bald groups, but I suppose it'll happen one day. Of course, there isn't time to include everyone who's had a best-selling record, but some of them you will recognize during the next 5 minutes, which are taken care of by a group who have themselves appeared on top of the pops. The Baron Knights.
One, two, three, four.
Go! Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way. We wonder what the other groups are doing this Christmas Day. We don't know, but we thought, and we have a hunch. This is what the Rolling Stones had for Christmas lunch.
Let's see what the jury think about this next Christmas song.
We've had to work hard all the year and had no time for fun.
This today, as we walk through the snow, I'll be kissing Santa Claus beneath the mistletoe.
Hello, my name's Pete Murray. I don't know what the rest of the Honeycombs would think about that. Do you?
Has she the right to kiss him? Because we know she'll miss him when he goes back until next year. Why don't you realize you haven't
this next group are three boys who deserve a rest. The next DJ might wish them a whiter than white Christmas.
Hi there, pop pickers. Here we have three bachelor boys. One from each wash, of course.
Wait for me. Might I end? I'll go out and get some more Christmas grub.
Christmas grub.
Hi there, guys and gals. The gals have had a great swinging year in 1964, and now we've got three of them to tell us exactly what happened when they ate their Christmas pud. Okay? Top of the pots to you all. Christmas Day. Pull up.
No, but seriously though, we'd like to pay tribute to four boys who gave British pop music a great big boost all over the world in 1964. The Beatles.
Baron Knights. As my garage man would say, there are a lot of lads, aren't they? I'll bet they keep busy. But there can be few people, I think, as busy at Christmas time as the postman. And yet only in recent years has he had his well-deserved day off on Christmas Day. I'm glad he has, and I'm sure you are too. But in one far-flung outpost of the RAF, there seems to be someone still delivering, and it looks suspiciously like Andy Stewart.
Hello, how are you? And a Merry Christmas to you from the north of Scotland. And when I say the north of Scotland, I mean the very north of the north of Scotland. Because I'm speaking to you from the RAF station, Saxe-Vord, on the island of Unst. The island of Unst is at the tip-top toe of the Shetland Islands. Let me give you some idea of our position in relation to the rest of Britain. Well, we are over 800 miles from London. It takes an airman 2 days to get from here to London, 3 days from London to here. You may think the nearest railway station would be Aberdeen, which is 180 miles away. In actual fact, it's in Bergen in Norway, 150 miles. I'm not very sure which. And I brought this tree because there are no trees on the island of Unst. And I've got to shout because the wind is probably somewhere around 100 miles per hour. Well, that's really going some, and it's time I was getting going because inside we're having a party. Let's go in and see what's doing.
Present. Who said what for?
gentlemen, what would you rather I had brought you? Did somebody say whiskey? Well, I couldn't bring you whiskey with me. They wouldn't let me bring it through the customs. But I can sing you a song about the man who first made whiskey. It was called Donald Doo. Thank you. Now listen here. Donald Doe was not the first to have what you would call a thirst, but he made sure we'd thirst no more by making Highland whiskey. So ho, ho,
Donald Doe, he's the boy for me and you.
Ho, ho,
Donald Doe, hooray for Highland whiskey.
Before the town of London grew and Paris was a village too, we Scotsmen drank to Donald Doe, the man who first made whiskey. So ho, ho,
Donald Doe, he's the boy for me and you.
Ho, ho,
Donald Doe, hooray for Highland whiskey.
The Japanese are really great in all that they can imitate, but one thing they can't recreate is good old Highland whiskey. So ho, ho, Donald Doe, he's the boy for me and you.
Ho, ho, Donald Doe, hooray for Highland whiskey.
No matter where you chance to be in this great world by land and sea, the magic words will still be heard as people call for whiskey. So ho, ho,
Donald Doe, he's the boy for me and you.
Ho, ho,
Donald Doe, the rapper Highland whiskey.
If Donald was alive today and saw the price we had to pay, these words I'm sure you'd hear him say, it's worth it, boys, for whiskey. So ho,
ho, Donald Doe, he's the boy for me and you.
Ho, ho,
thanks, Andy Stewart. Well, so much for the far-flung corners of the RAF. Oh, I'm sorry, one of my grandfathers was a Scot. Now, what about the near-flung corners of, let's say, Tooting? Or to be more exact, 33 Lobelia Avenue. There's a party going on there which I think you might like to join. The hosts are none other than Terry Scott and Hugh Lloyd, better known to you and me as Hugh and I.
Anyone would think we'd added the entire borough of Tooting to lunch.
Well, three Crispins, two Wormholes, three of us, that's only eight.
Yeah. I thought they might have given us a hand out here.
You told them to sit tight and not bother. You said you'd do it all.
Yeah, I mean, that was just a gesture, wasn't it? I never thought they'd take me up on it.
Oh, well, it only comes once a year.
If anyone else says that today, I'll crown them, honestly.
Now, Terry, peace and goodwill. That's what the vicar said this morning.
Yeah. He wasn't standing up to his elbows in cold, greasy water.
Mum did us a lovely dinner, though, didn't she?
Yeah, she did, yeah. Yeah, she filled them so full they can't keep their eyes open.
Oh, well, it only comes once a year. You've ruined your shirt.
Right, that's it. That's it. No more. No more. Let's go and get the party started.
Listen, they're quite happy watching the telly.
We'll soon put a stop to that.
Hey, hey, he's not going home time already, is he?
No, I thought we'd have a bit of a game and a giggle.
Here, Miss Elder.
What?
My liver's upset again. I can't see the picture.
I've turned it off.
You what?
Wakey, wakey, come out. We're all going to have a game.
What sort of a game?
Well, we could warm up with a couple of rounds of murder.
Oh, Terry, dear.
Here, what about a nice game of musical bumps?
What's that?
Bumps, Cecil. Musical bumps.
Who has?
I don't think Mum's quite nippy enough for that.
Yeah, what about Postman's Knock?
Yes.
No. Got it?
What
about that one where you all sit round and you tap your knees three times and on the fourth beat you don't tap your knees but you say a word?
What word?
Well, anywhere that comes into your head.
Is that all? Oh.
Yes.
Well, it doesn't sound very exciting.
No, well, then you all tap your knees again 3 times, but this time the person next to you has to say a word connected with the word that you said. Look, I'll show it to you. Yeah. Just watch me. Yeah. Right. Oh, like this, you see. Three times. Yeah. Ink. Pen. Blotting paper.
He said blotting paper.
Who did?
Mr. Lloyd.
What for?
It's a game.
A game called blotting paper?
No, Cecil, no.
Oh, blimey, you started something here, mate.
You catch on later when we've started.
Well, it seems a pretty rum way to spend Christmas.
I think it could be quite fun.
Yes, but you see, the whole thing is you've got to get a good rhythm going with it, you see. And if on the fourth beat you can't think of a word, then you're out.
Ooh. Yeah, right. Okay, all ready then? Yeah. Come on then, let's let Cabelia Avenue, let's set it alight with a great fire.
Right. Now, we'll start with Norma.
Ooh. Right, Norma, have you got your knees ready?
Like that?
Sure. Right.
Would you like to check everybody's knees before we start?
No, I think we can take those as red.
Yeah. Right, we start with Norma, then on to Mr. Crispin. Right, have you thought of something, Norma?
Yeah.
Oh, we'll try and think of something else.
Right, off we go now, beginning with Norma, then Mr. Crispin. Right, off we go. 1, 2, 3.
Party!
Labour!
What?
Labour!
Well, what's Labour got to do with a party?
Labour party!
Well, that's right.
Right, you're out, Terry.
Wait a minute. What do you mean out?
Look, if you challenge somebody and they're right, then you're out.
Well, look, we were only practising, weren't we? Let's do it again properly.
Right, all right, then. Okay. Just one more line.
Okay, right.
Right, we'll start with Mr. Crispin this time. Right, ready, steady, go. Right.
Fire!
Water!
Drink!
Boozer! It's a good idea. Open.
Sit down!
You see, Mrs. Wernold said boozer. Now you have to tap your knees 3 times and then say a word.
I'll explain it to you. We'll be here till Easter. Listen, you. Have you got rhythm? Got rhythm? Yeah. I'll show it to you. Look, supposing she says brum 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 wicker. See? Then you've got brum, brum, brum to think of a word that goes with wicker. See? Have you got it?
Am I to know what goes with wicker?
Well, basket, see? Basket goes with wicker. A basket's made of wicker. Okay, so it's 1, 2, 3. Wicker! 1, 2, 3.
Basket!
That's it.
Oh, good!
Basket!
Yeah. Well done, Cecil! Yeah.
Basket!
Yeah. Okay.
But it won't necessarily be anything you've thought of. It might be something that you have no idea of what it is. But suddenly, when she says that, you'll think of something else and you'll come out with it. I hope. So we're gonna try it then, okay? Mum's gonna start and then it'll go over to there, right? Off we go then, ready? 1, 2, 3.
Whiskey.
Scotland. Bagpipes.
A wind.
Harvey, you carry on. Oh, good evening, Vicar.
You didn't say I might call round. It'll only be for a few minutes.
Yes, so do come in. Join the party. Oh, what a lovely surprise. Do come in. Vicar! Basket!
No!
Now, on these Christmas night shows, we usually present stars from popular comedy series which have been shown throughout the year. Tonight's case, however, is a little unusual because we're going to feature a brand new series called The Likely Lads, and it started only a fortnight ago on BBC Two. The show stars James Bolam and Rodney Bewes, who play the parts of Terry and Bob, two young North Country lads. We see them now at Terry's house at about 9:30 on Christmas Eve. Both boys are feeling a little fragile after the traditional lunchtime Christmas drink at the factory.
Hey, he's not due yet, you know.
Who isn't?
Santa. In any case, you're supposed to hang him up, not stand there and catch him when he bungs him down the floor.
I'm warming me socks, you nit. And how did you get in?
Door's open. Where's your mum and dad?
In the front room. Mince pies and Empire sherry.
It's 9:30, you know.
Hey, I better get a move on. How do you feel?
Terrible. It's the same every year, that lunchtime session at work.
I don't know why they open the factory Christmas Eve. 11, everybody's over the pub, nobody gets back until 3, and then they're half mortal. I must have had about 6 pints.
6? You'd have that many before I passed out.
You were well aware. What were you drinking?
Rum and pep.
I didn't know you drank rum.
I don't anymore.
Hey, she was knocking them back in all mind.
Who?
Elsie.
The canteen girl?
Yeah.
Who did she end up with?
You!
Never.
Anything there?
I can't remember. Elsie?
Well, even Elsie looks good after 6 pints.
Yeah, that's all people think about round here at Christmas, drinking.
I hope there's our Audrey. There's been a do at the salon.
Oh, I thought I saw a boyfriend's car out there.
Oh, hello, Bob. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas, Aud. What are you doing tonight, then?
Oh, Mario's taking me to a party. He's coming for me about 11.
You've been a long time in that car, haven't you?
So?
I know it's a season of goodwill to all men, but what you give him in that back seat is ridiculous.
Don't you miss a cheeky. Where are you going tonight anyway, Bob?
Oh, there's an orgy somewhere. We're meeting the lads in the pub in 30 minutes.
I don't know why you don't stop him for a change with your families.
What? Catch me staying in. Bowl of nuts, box of dates, and Christmas night with the stars. No, thank you.
Well, all I can say is don't come begging aspirin off me tomorrow morning.
She better watch it. She won't get her present.
What have you got her?
Penknife.
That's nice. My juice is right, you know.
How do you mean?
Well, I can't remember a Christmas morning I woke up with a clear head.
Yeah, you got a point there. Still.
It was so different when you were a kiddie. I never got to bed until 10 o'clock on Christmas Eve, and I knew that Santa would come into my room at 2 o'clock.
Dear me.
I used to stay awake until he came, but I'd never let on. I'd breathe deeply and open 30 minutes. And then, one year, I suppose I was about 8, I realised for the first time it was me dad all dressed up. I can still remember him standing over the bed. He put me presents in me stocking, then he went to the door and he stopped. I knew he was looking at me, so I closed my eyes tight. He came back. He leant over, kissed me on the forehead.
Fell downstairs and broke his leg.
Blind drunk. His breath nearly knocked me out.
Well, that's it, isn't it? It's all in the Christmas tradition, getting plastered. There's one Christmas in every bloke's life. When he first reaches out for a fizzy tablet instead of a Rupert annual.
Aye, I remember Rupert, the little bear.
You should remember him, you look like him.
Don't be daft.
No, man, honestly, if you had a little check scarf and a red sweater.
Yeah.
And your little furry ears.
Oh, get off. Don't be childish. Anyway, you look like Algy the pug.
Algy who?
Algy the pug, don't you remember him? Rupert's mate.
Oh, aye, the pug, yeah. Well, yeah, lots of mates, Rupert. I remember them all.
I remember now. Mm. And there was an elephant, too.
Aye, that's right. Edward. Edward the elephant.
Yeah. No, it wasn't. Edward Trunk, that was it.
No, it was Edward the elephant.
It was Edward Trunk.
Look, man, I know it was Edward the elephant. I used to have an annual every year till I was 12.
Well, I had them till I was 15. Edward Trunk.
It was Edward the rotten elephant.
You're wrong.
10 bob on it.
Right, you're on. Look, man, I remember this story. It was Santa's magic garden. And all the little animals were there. And Edward Trunk pulled the sledge. Because the reindeer got took poorly.
I know. Santa's Magic Garden, 1954. Edward the Elephant. 10 bob on it.
You're chucking away good money.
10 bob?
Right, you're on.
I'll go and get them. They're in the loft.
Right.
Next one. Get the contents.
Right, then. For 10 shillings, who was in Rupert and the Umbrella Man?
Well, there was Rupert.
Correct.
There was Rupert and, Tiger Lily, the Chinese bit.
Wrong.
Oh, well, hang on, hang on.
10, 9, 8...
Oh, shut up a minute!
7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2...
Bingo the pup?
Nope, time's up. It was Bill Badger, Podgy Pig, Rupert's dad and Edward Trunk. £7 you owe me.
Right. Right, well, here's a tough one. 1949. You'll never get this one. For 10 bob, who was in Rupert's Secret Journey?
Ferdy Fox, Bill Badger and Pong Ping the Pekingese. Right. £7.10.
I don't want to interrupt.
What the hell do you want?
But does Algie the Pug and Edward Trump know the pub's closed 10 minutes ago?
What? Get away.
Yeah, it's 11:10. Well, I'm off out anyway. I'm going to be party. Santa's magic garden.
She could have told us before. That's rotten, that. I'm going to keep that penknife for myself.
Oh, forget it, man. Sit down and shut up.
Forget it? Do you realise we're in for the night?
Well, it can't be helped.
Oh, would you like a nut? Or shall I go and get the crackers? I wouldn't care, but I haven't been across the doors and I've spent a fortune. She could have told us.
Oh, Terry, man, give over. For once, try and be nice about your sister. I mean, this is the one time of the year when you could be pleasant and not blow your top. After all, it is Christmas Eve. I know there's a lot of slush talked about Christmas, but being pleasant doesn't cost you much, does it? That's something I do believe in.
No?
Yes. Bit of goodwill being shown, that's not much to ask now, is it?
You're quite right, Bob. People should show goodwill. Especially now.
Quite.
And I think you could show a bit of goodwill for a start.
Gladly. What?
Let us off that £7.10 I owe you.
Get stuffed!
Ladies and gentlemen, during the last year, one of the most popular acts I had the pleasure of introducing on our show was Ralph Reeder's Boy Scout Gang Show. So tonight, we thought...
Here, mister, are you Billy Cotton?
Well, I don't look like Kathy Kirby, do I?
Well, here's your Christmas pudding.
What's all this, then?
Well, we Boy Scouts would always do good turns for the old folks at Christmas.
Old folks? What do you mean? Boys want to do a really good turn, you can get all your lot to do their act for us now, eh?
Righto, mister, but it'll cost you.
Cost you? It'll cost you something if it's not good. Off it! Ladies and gentlemen, the Gang Show!
When you hear a man begin to play, all along the way, it shall hooray. When the band begins to play, there
around, old Bill, doesn't he? Makes me feel thirsty. Now, Christmas, as we all know, is a time when we should give a little thought to those worse off than ourselves, and there are many. Under this heading, we're informed, comes one particular unfortunate, a certain Mr. Benny Hill.
Willie Tredder, aged 18, occupation unemployed. Some say he is unemployable. He is at the moment on probation.
Sometimes, like, I think I'd like to be like someone important, you know, like respected and that, like Albert Schweitzer or Screaming Lord Sutch or something. You know, I don't talk to him. But most of the time, I think I'd rather hang about.
This is the street where Willie lives with his parents. Significantly, perhaps, Willie's room is in the basement.
Grand, she like thinks we'll get married, you know. And well, I've got this girl, you know. I've got her a ring, you know. It's lovely, like, you know, it's all like gold plated, and it's got a place to put a stone and everything. Like, it's the accommodation, isn't it, you know. I mean, like, she couldn't like live here because there's no room, and we couldn't like go and live with her parents because they're living with theirs. And now, like, I'm on the probation.
How did it all start? Where did Willie go wrong?
As I was saying, chilly down here, Venezuela, and of course, the Brazil a little more over there. But not far off. Oh, well done. 5 days later, I'm off you go. Yes, Willie Tredder, yes. Well, he wasn't the sort of child you really could grow fond of, you know. He knew far too many vulgar songs, for one thing. Some of them were quite disgraceful. Where he got hold of them, I'll never know.
You mean he actually sang them in your presence?
No, he whistled them. And another thing, he kept taking things that didn't belong to him. He was always doing this. And then one day, I realized why he did this. He was a thief. I thought he might have grown out of it, but I do believe the youth club leader had the same trouble.
No, no, I disagree entirely. I think that society must take its own share of the blame. I think the whole moral structure of this country today is far too laxative. I'll give you a for instance. Along the side of the escalator at London's Piccadilly Circus Underground, there are no fewer than 17 different illustrated advertisements for ladies' corsets and lingerie.
17?
17, yes, I counted. And pictures like that could turn a young man's head.
But surely the escalator travels so quickly that one only sees these pictures for a second or two.
I disagree entirely, I disagree. If you go down the one that's coming up, or up the one that's going down, you can look at these disgraceful advertisements for quite a long time. Mind you, it makes you unpopular with the other passengers, but it can be done.
Are you sure?
I've done it several times. I've heard of it being done several times. Honestly, I think parents today should keep a tighter rein on their children. I do really.
But, like, since he's joined the probation, I mean, like, no one would come to his Christmas party, nor nothing. I mean, it's, like, it's only the vicar and the doctor come here now. So it's just like we was cut off.
Has he gone yet?
Do what, Gran?
Has the vicar gone yet?
Yes, he's gone, dear, and it was the vicar. The doctor.
I thought he was a bit familiar for the vicar.
At the probation, the psychiatrist up there said he couldn't help it, see? Like a psychopath. He hits these old ladies because he hates his father, you see. That's why he does it, because he hates his father.
But why doesn't he hit his father?
His father kill him. He's 6'4". Yeah, I think it's up to the probation.
Willie Tredder came under your care on June the 17th, didn't he?
No. It was July the 15th. I remember it quite well, because that was the day I was asked to join the local council. We need people like you, said the Lady Mayoress. People who really care about the youth of this town.
What sort of a person is he?
Who?
Willie Tredder.
Oh, yes, that's all right. But I myself, I turned to the Lady Mayoress and I said, of course I care about the youth of this town. I said, I was a juvenile delinquent myself once, but I stopped it. How, said she, I grew up, said I. This, the Lady Mayoress, who's rather on the plump side, fairly shook with laughter.
Well, they must be quite a handful.
Well, delinquents always are.
He's not a jubilant delinquent. He just like a high-spirited, that's all.
His foreman thought differently.
I want workers there, not picnics, you know. He comes in here wearing that dirty T-shirt and them open-neck trousers. When he gets here, he doesn't do any work. He's bent up his time in. Are you going to be in there all day? I mean, it's not as if he's reading the racing results.
Of all the 97 jobs Willie has had since he left school, none has lasted more than a few days.
About is that television
of it?
He watches everything that's on.
He does any harm on a television? Because I mean, like, if say, like you're watching something like The Saint, or No Hiding Place, or Panorama. I mean, you know it's not real, don't you? I mean, you know it's only like made up, innit? It's all like made up, you know.
It's not the harm it does now. It's what it can lead to. I mean, what happens when a boy gets his hands on Mary Anna?
Who?
Not who, what, Mary Anna. You know what I mean, Reavers. I mean, he lights one up just for kicks, and the next thing you know, he's a smoked addict. Smoke addict. And then no one can help him.
Here then is Willie Treader, a lonely, misunderstood young man, perhaps more to be pitied than blamed. Let us not condemn his displays of youthful high spirits, for that is what they are, simply youthful high spirits. Perhaps it would be well if, at this Christmas time, we showed people like Willie a little more understanding, a little more tolerance, a little more...
Hey, that's my car. You little thief. Police! Police! Come back here, Willie Turner!
Poor Benny. But there are, of course, two others on the domestic scene who'll be busy celebrating Christmas. Did I say two? Well... that's not quite accurate. As I recall from the last edition of Marriage Lines, there's a third on the way. The starling's nest is due to be enlarged, as you'll be able to see when the series returns in a couple of weeks. Now, why don't we look in and see how Christmas is faring with George and Kate, alias Richard Briers and Prunella Scales.
Darling, I'll let you lie in a bit in case you'd had a bad night.
Oh, thank you, darling.
Whoa, wait, wait, let me give you a hand. Oh. It's your dressing gown. How did you sleep?
Oh, like a log.
Oh, did you? Oh, splendid.
Darling, babies keep you awake after they're born. It's not too bad before.
Oh, here's your tea. I was just thinking, this time next year I'll be putting on a red dressing gown with a cotton wool beard.
Christmas?
Well, you never know. I mean, a child of mine's not going to be short on intelligence, is he? Let me do it.
Thank you. Nice music.
Oh, yes, yes, on the radio, yeah. It's funny, it was a record on the radio that made me think of it, you know, about how children really make a Christmas.
What record?
Just now, I don't know what it's called, but it was all about how this little boy cleared the snow away from a patch of grass in his garden so that Santa's reindeer would have something to chew. I thought it was... rather moving. Morty?
No, thank you, darling. I'm dying to get at the present.
Oh, okay. Mind how you go now. Careful. Here, I'll get your slippers. There we are. Whoa, steady. I'm to ask Dennis tonight if his three kids made any difference to Christmas. I think it's an awfully good idea of his to throw a do on Christmas night, don't you? I mean, you know, you have lunch and you have a snooze and you wake up and the day's sort of over, isn't it, normally? It'll be fun to go out again.
Oh, well, actually,
well, that reminds me, darling, I must phone and confirm that we're going.
Darling?
Yes, what?
Would you mind terribly if we didn't go to Dennis's tonight?
What?
Well, if we've been out all day, I might be feeling a bit tired.
But I told him yesterday, you know, I said we would. I said I'd check with you first, but he took it we were coming.
Oh, well, you better go then.
What? Without you?
Yes, I'll go to bed when we get back from my parents.
Oh, no, 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 I can't go alone.
Well, can't you?
Good heavens, no. I mean, what will people think?
Oh, thank you, darling.
Oh, well, I better ring him up then.
Oh, let's open our presents first. Happy Christmas, darling.
Good Lord, what on earth is it?
Well, actually, darling, I didn't know what to give you. I searched the shops and you seemed to have everything. And then I thought, well, perhaps it ought to be a practical present this year. I mean, life and I will be getting a bit expensive next month. We mustn't waste money on luxuries. It's a sleeping bag, darling. You see? You get in here.
A sleeping bag?
Yes. For nights when the baby's noisy, you can move in here. It's all right on the floor. You try it. Oh, there's a cigar as well.
What's that for? The christening?
Listen, polite, darling. You haven't said thank you.
What? Oh, sorry, darling. Thank you very much.
Do you really like it?
Yes, it's lovely.
Well, it's practical.
Yes, it certainly is. Yes.
Hope you got me something practical.
Oh, well, no, I didn't actually, darling, but never mind.
George, whatever is it?
Unwrap it and see.
I hope you haven't spent too much money on me.
Well, I must admit, it wasn't cheap. How about that then, eh? I've always wanted to buy you something to wear, but I've never been sure of your size before. I mean, it was easy this time. I just said maternity, you see. Wait, isn't it the right size?
Oh, yes, darling. I'm maternity all right, yes. Only for another month.
Another month? Oh, no, 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 but surely I thought it was due in...
Honestly, darling, this is the 8th month. I'm not an elephant.
No, I know. Do you know, I was absolutely certain it was due in... Well, you see, it's the first time I've ever known your...
Yes.
And you said how sick you were of your other things.
Oh, yes, darling, it's lovely.
Mm. Are you sure?
Mm. And it'll come in useful next time, won't it? What did you get the baby, darling?
What?
This is what I got it. And Mum sent it some cot blankets. Wasn't that kind of her? And there's a bib from Peter and Nora. And Margaret sent it a rattle. You didn't get it a rattle, did you, darling? As soon as I saw that one, I thought, I bet George has got it a rattle. You did get it a rattle. Oh, well, never mind. I expect they break the patterns. You didn't. Well, what then?
Oh, Kate, I mean, I didn't know. I mean, we don't even know what sex is.
How does sex come into a rattle?
Well, I'm sorry, darling. I just didn't know.
But I told you last week, don't forget to buy it something.
But I thought you were joking.
George, this baby hasn't been a joke for 8 whole months now.
You're telling me.
What?
Nothing.
No, go on.
Well... if he's going to be cock of the walk 4 weeks before he's even born, I reckon I'll be using that sleeping bag at the office.
Cock of the walk?
Well, he's not doing too badly, is he, for an invisible baby? He's done us out of tonight's party. He's turned Christmas morning into a slagging match.
Oh, nuts.
It's true, you can't deny it. At this very moment, I'm in disgrace because I didn't lash out on a ruddy potty. Well, all I can say is he'll have to work pretty hard to get me on his side when he does arrive, so I'd personally not recommend him to push his luck.
Well, you might have to work pretty hard too, you know. He hasn't made up his mind about you yet.
Oh, hasn't he? Well, here's one consolation he's not going to have. I'm going to ring up Dennis right now and tell him I'm going tonight.
Well, I'm not.
No, I wouldn't. You sit here and have a nice chat with little Mr. Mixit.
Hello?
Ah, hello, Dennis. Happy Christmas.
Who's
Who's that?
George, look, I'm afraid Kate can't come tonight.
Oh, George, I'm glad you rang. I couldn't find your number. Listen, I'm sorry, it's all off tonight.
What time do you want me off?
I'm sorry, yes, George. The baby's running a very high temperature. They do that, you know, quite suddenly. Last night she was gurgling away, and this morning she's lying in her cot all limp. Well, it's nothing to worry about, of course. We had it with the other two. Except that you can't help worrying, can you? The doctor's on an answering service, and, well, we're waiting for him to ring back. Babies do pick the worst time, don't they?
I'm terribly sorry, Liz. Is there anything we can do?
No, no. Just apologize to Kate and say we'll make it up for another time. You wait, it'll be happening to you soon. Just remember, there's no need to worry.
No.
But it's jolly hard not to. They're so tiny. Well, I'd better ring off. The doctor might be trying
to... Yes, of course, yes.
I'm sorry about tonight.
Oh, good heavens, Liz. I hope everything will be all right.
Thanks, George. Well, happy Christmas.
Happy Christmas, Dennis.
I didn't realize you were against babies, George. I think you might have said so before.
Dennis's baby's very ill.
What?
It's got a very high temperature. They're waiting for the doctor.
Oh, on Christmas Day.
Well, they always pick the worst time, you know. I mean, it might not be anything too serious. Their temperatures do fly up and down. But, you know, it's so difficult not to worry when they're so tiny, isn't it? Well, they're all waiting for the... They're waiting for the doctor. I was just thinking, look, do you think it's a good idea if we ring him back and offer to babysit?
Oh, yes, of course.
Yeah, because, you know, I mean, if the baby goes to hospital, they want to go with it, wouldn't they? So shall I ring them then?
Yes.
You sure?
Yes, darling. I think it's a lovely idea.
Thanks, darling.
I'll get dressed.
There was another series which made its bow this year, which is proving equally popular in a different way, of course, because it's a musical show. Yes, you've guessed it, the Kathy Kirby Show. And if that isn't a cue for song, I don't know what is. Ladies and gentlemen, Kathy Kirby.
Have yourself a merry little Christmas. Keep the Yuletide gay. All our troubles will be far away. Have yourself a merry little Christmas. Let your hearts be gay. Next year all our troubles will be miles away. Once again as in olden days, happy golden days of yore. Faithful friends dear to us will be near to us once more. Someday soon we all will be together if the fates allow. Until then we'll have to muddle through somehow. So have yourself a merry little Christmas now.
That, I think, is a sentiment in which we all join. And now, if you've got a glass handy, even if it's only a glass of milk before going to bed, perhaps you'd like to join me in another toast. To a spirit of Christmas amongst us all. Not just on Christmas Day, but every day. So, a Merry Christmas and a happy and a prosperous New Year. Good night.